Okay, I'd like to thank you all for attending the Eurista Texas Speaker Series, October 2021. It's been a great year and can't believe we're already in our 10th month of the year. Got a great presentation for you today. The topic is using GIS for hazardous materials planning in Dallas County, Texas. We have Bernardo Salazar is doing the presentation today. He is a certified urban planner and a GISP as well. So he's got a very, very diverse backgrounds working for nonprofits and community designs, political campaigns, but the essential part of his duties is hazardous materials planning for Dallas counties. And he uses some pretty amazing applications in, such as data analysis, visualizing, and web mapping, some very in-depth Python and analytical tools and scripting tools like R and things like that. So Bernardo, we really want to go ahead and thank you for being here today. And I'm going to go ahead and turn it over to you, and we will have a Q&A after the presentation. Thank you.
Sounds good. Thank you, Brian. Thank you, Ollie. I really appreciate, you know, getting the opportunity to speak with all of you about, you know, what we're doing here at the county in terms of hazmat planning and using GIS. I think one of the great things about, you know, being here at the county is that, you know, we have a lot of creative freedom to explore the applications that, you know, GIS provides. And so I do want to talk a little bit about my background. As Brian mentioned, there's a little bit of everything in there. So I've been the hazmat planner for the Dallas County Office of Homeland Security and Emergency Management for the last 3 years. The role was originally posted as a GIS planner. So, you know, that gives you an idea of, you know, what I got into. And in previous roles, I was an analytics associate at a community design nonprofit. And my primary tools involve, you know, R. I love R. This is one of the tools that I kind of default to. Python is there too. So if you're a Python programmer, you know, I don't think you can get too upset with me. I use GIS and Adobe Creative Suite. And as Brian mentioned, I'm a certified urban planner and a certified GISP. I have a master's in urban planning and a BA in sociology. And so a little bit about today's presentation. We're going to keep it pretty straightforward, to the point. I don't want to confuse a lot of us or a lot of you about, you know, hazmat planning. So what I want to do is I want to cover, you know, quickly some notable Texas hazmat incidents, and then move on to the EPCRA, or the Emergency Planning and Community Right to Know Act, that was passed in the 80s, and how that shapes local emergency planning committees, or basically, you know, the EPCRA established local APC committees to help kind of plan for any chemical related incidents. And then talk a little bit about how Dallas County's LAPC, since I'm the chair of the Dallas County LAPC, how we're working to improve hazard preparedness across, or hazmat preparedness across the county. And then we'll cover some tools, not just GIS tools, but also other tools that were created by the EPA for, or they were created specifically for hazmat data, and then kind of cover some overview of the, you know, different data sources that we use. And then we'll go into, you know, our GIS project showcase. I split that into three groups. You know, we are looking at traditional applications of GIS, so, you know, simple maps, and then research applications for GIS. And then the third section is kind of the more exploratory and innovative uses of GIS in hazmat planning. And then we'll wrap it up with a, you know, an idea of, you know, what next steps might be. And if I can get my clicker to work. Okay. So one of the most notable hazmat incidents over the last 10 years has been the West Texas fertilizer incident. And this, you know, incident really kind of reinvigorated discussions around hazmat planning and why we need to kind of invest in making sure that we understand where chemical or what types of chemicals are stored and how we share that information. So this happened, you know, in McLennan County, where Waco is seated, back in 2013. And it was kind of a pivotal moment in hazmat history, meaning, you know, it kind of made us reassess how we're going and, you know, how we're using data and GIS in terms of making sure that we're aware of all these different hazards in our communities. And this one in particular is, you know, very kind of, it's a kind of an incident that highlighted where things go wrong in hazmat planning, meaning the lack of information sharing, you know, where chemicals are stored, land use around chemical or chemical facilities, right? So you can see the apartments there at the northern section of the image, and just kind of knowledge from the training side. So in this incident, I think there were 15 volunteer firefighters who lost their lives. And part of that, again, is not understanding what chemicals were on site, which chemicals were on fire, and then using the inadequate response for that. And so this is, again, one of the incidents that really highlights the importance of hazmat planning. And then one of the more recent ones was the Watson Grinding Manufacturing incident in Houston, Texas. This was in 2020. Again, one of the issues here was not having, a couple of meetings ago, we invited the hazmat person from Harris County to come in and talk about the Watson Grinding Manufacturing incident. And what he mentioned on that call was kind of not having information around a particular chemical at that site. You know, the site did report chemicals to the state and to the local fire departments, but one chemical wasn't really listed in that report. So I wanted to highlight that only because, you know, it's in Houston, it's recent, and again, it illustrates the kind of need for chemical information sharing. And then locally, here we have the Polyamerica fire in Grand Prairie. This was again in 2020. And Polyamerica is one of the facilities that creates your plastic bags. So what you see there on fire is, you know, plastic pellets. And so there was a electrical power line that landed on those pellets and, you know, ignited the pellets. And because they were so closely together, they just burn. And this fire lasted several days. And this one I don't want to say it hits home, but this was in our backyard. This was in Dallas County. And one of the things that I took away from this was, you know, at the time we were focused more on ammonia chemicals and chlorine because, you know, these chemicals are can expand or can, you know, when they're released, they can travel across, you know, a pretty, you know, great distance. And so we really didn't focus too much on, you know, plastic or other flammable materials. And so this one kind of made me rethink, you know, maybe we should be looking at facilities that, you know, store a lot of these flammable materials and, you know, see if we can prepare for those incidents. And so again, the goal of, you know, sharing these slides is to kind of, you know, drive home the point of why we need to, you know, prepare for hazmat incidents and be aware of that. Again, the main idea or the main focus for my role is to make sure that we can identify the chemicals across Dallas County, that we can relay that information to fire folks and emergency managers, and then the public, and then use that information to develop plans or some type of, you know, pre-plan or trainings to make sure that we're prepared in the event of an incident. Because again, it's not that, you know, we're trying to avoid these incidents. These incidents are going to happen. And when we do, we want to make sure that they're mitigated or that we are proactive in our approach. And again, GIS is, you know, for the work that we're doing, GIS is kind of the tool that helps us kind of, you know, meet our goals. And so I kind of preview the Emergency Planning and Community Right to Know Act. So again, this started with an incident in India back in 84. It's the Union Carbide chemical plant. And so during the evening of December 2nd and 3rd, the chemical plant had a release, and that release ended up you know, killing around 2,000 folks. That incident kind of, you know, made Congress aware of the need for understanding the risks of chemicals at, you know, at the community level. So in 86, it passed the Community Right to Know Act, and that established the Local Emergency Planning Committee, or LEPCs, and the chemical reporting requirements. So the tier two reports, and these are in Texas, the tier two reports are managed by the Texas Commission on Environmental Quality, TCEQ, and they receive reports from facilities storing chemicals at a certain threshold. And then there's also a list of, you know, chemicals known as extremely hazardous substances list that is a, you know, list of chemicals that you have to report regardless of, you know, weight or threshold requirements. And again, the reaffirmation for HAZMAT planning after West, you know, the West explosion. I have a little bit more details here. Again, 15 people were killed, more than 160 were injured, and more than 150 buildings were damaged or destroyed in the incident. And I, you know, local emergency planning committees. So the goal of the local emergency planning committees, again, is to gather as much information about chemicals in the community and share that with local local jurisdictions, emergency managers, and, you know, first responders. They're also responsible for developing chemical plans or chemical incident plans. And then again, over the last couple of years, they've, you know, with the 2013 incident in West Texas, they've kind of been more proactive in terms of how they work. And across Texas, you have, you know, each county has its own LEPC, and each LEPC is going to have its own, you know, it's going to have its own folks or committee that are working with local first responders to ensure that, you know, they're prepared for any incident. A little bit about the Dallas County LEPC. We've been around for 30 years. We have memberships that include people from all over or different sectors. We're looking at transportation folks. We're looking at emergency managers, nonprofits, environmental groups. So we're trying to have a broad-based membership. We have a website on our county site that provides more information about, you know, what we do. You can also check our bylaws that are posted there. We also have the meetings for our LEPCs listed there. And again, I serve as the chair of the LEPC. So again, our office is pretty involved with how the LEPC works. And so, you know, what are some of our planning goals? Again, our goal is to make sure that we develop partnership with local jurisdictions and facilities. We've been working closely with the HAZMAT team at the city of Dallas. Anytime they need some kind of GIS tools or maps or some kind of assistance from us, you know, we're more than happy to kind of get involved. Again, we like to, one of our goals is to address some planning or resource gaps, and then create tools or documents that might help or facilitate any sort of training or awareness about certain chemicals. And again, the overall arching goal here is to enhance our understanding of hazmat threats across Dallas County. And the last thing here, we have, you know, identifying best practices. So again, each city is going to, you know, because each city kind of has its own, you know, fire folks there. Each city has its own fire folks that kind of have different knowledge sets. And so we want to identify that we can share the best practices with, you know, our fire folks across the county. And so the way we work with facilities is, you know, oftentimes we'll have a site visit at, you know, their invitation. We'll go in, we'll do a quick inspection with the fire departments and the HAZMAT team. And then we invite them to participate at our local LEPC meetings. And one of the other things that we've been developing recently is one pagers to help them update their data more accurately. One of the things that we'll cover later in our showcase is lat long coordinates and the need for more accurate lat long coordinates. And so our one pager kind of focuses on, you know, accurate location coordinates for reporting processes or reporting requirements. And then with jurisdictions, we like to sit down and kind of go over some of their chemical or some of the chemicals that are stored within their jurisdictions. We discuss hazmat issues. We identify projects to work on. One of the projects that we've done in the past with the City of Addison is a hazard vulnerability analysis, and we'll cover that in the showcase. And then with the City of Box Springs, we've done, you know, and you can see here in the slide, we have a, you know, image of the, you know, tabletop exercise with Box Springs. And then Cedar Hill, we've developed a tier two facility map, which is, again, one of the projects that we've been kind of working on over the last couple of years to kind of improve the functionality of it and, you know, the familiarity for emergency managers. And so I'll cover tools. Again, some of you may be familiar with the Cameo tool suite. It's a software suite that the EPA established to make sure that emergency managers can work with the tier two reports. So we have the Cameo data manager. So you can use the tier two reports to import into the Cameo data manager and kind of do some simple quick analysis using that software. You can do plume modeling using the Aloha software. And then there's some mapping capabilities with the Marplot tool. And then Cameo Chemicals is a chemical database. You can search any chemical that you are working with, and it'll give you some kind of response guide or some kind of additional information to be aware of when you're working with that chemical. And so, as I mentioned earlier, some of the tools that we use are in Python. We use these tools for data cleaning, data analysis, mapping, sometimes data scraping. GIS, we use QGIS or ArcMap. That's how old I am. I am using ArcMap. And then basically we use that for geoprocesses, map layouts, and publishing. So whenever we have a report to compile, we use QGIS or ArcMap to, you know, make those or prepare those maps in. And so a lot of our data sources come from, you know, state and federal sources. So we, as I mentioned earlier, the TCEQ here, that's where we pull our tier two information from. The National Response Center is basically anytime you have a spill, it gets reported, and the Coast Guard and its National Response Center store that information and they share it on their site. CFATS, that's another program from the Department of Homeland Security that, you know, covers regulated facilities. And then, you know, OSHA, and, you know, we have a lot of data here that, you know, we want to make sure that we incorporate into our analysis. Again, I'm a data person, so I like to include as much data as we can. And so, all right, not to the fun stuff. So as promised, this presentation is about how we're using GIS for hazmat planning. And so I break down our projects into three different categories. I break it down into traditional, research, and experimental. And for the traditional one, we're looking at something, you know, for example, with the City of Addison, we conducted a hazard chemical analysis project. We did some pre-planning with other sites that, you know, we identified, for example, sites that are storing ammonia or chlorine. And then for research, this is more kind of, you know, how do we better understand the landscape, or how can we better understand chemicals and our populations across Dallas County? So I'll talk a little bit about the cumulative vulnerability index that I worked with one of our masters in public health interns a while back, preliminary tank form analysis. So back when Deer Park had their fires, one of our commissioners was curious about if we had any similar facilities in the county. And then TCEQ has a database that you can search for any finds related to the facilities that we have on our tier two reporting system. And then experimental, that one is more sort of, you know, working with the tier two reports, there's some limitations with the data quality and the way the data is set up. It's, you know, it's, you have a bunch of tables that are linked together, and it's not easy to just, you know, it's not on one singular spreadsheet or data frame. It's more, you know, one data frame will have the facilities, and then you have several tables that are linking to a chemical inventory or to a contact list. And so working with that can be a little bit challenging at times. And so I think that's one of the reasons why a lot of, you know, what we're doing is unique, since we're a data savvy team. We're able to kind of dig in through the tier two and kind of create a lot of these different new products, or I wouldn't even say products, but kind of just new analysis, only because, and again, I'm not sure if there are a lot of other folks who are doing the same thing with the tier two reports. And we'll cover those in detail in the preceding slides. So, as I mentioned, this is one of, you know, the hazardous chemical vulnerability analysis with the city of Addison. This is a pretty straightforward kind of a GIS application. We're using layers. So on the left-hand side, we have, you know, the tier two report locations, you know, the different facilities that were reported around the city of Addison. And we did some buffering. I forget which or how far of a buffer we did, or we, you know, how much of a buffer we created for these facilities. And then we looked at pipelines, we looked at roadways, highways, and then finally railways. And so we kind of just, you know, this is a pretty straightforward project. We kind of brought in together some data layers and, you know, provided a quick and dirty look at, you know, some vulnerability for the city of Addison. Again, the city of Addison, you know, it's a pretty small city, but, you know, it was a way for us to kind of bring in those GIS resources to a department that's fairly small. So that's one way we work with GIS. Another way that we use traditional GIS is with pre-planning and site reports. So again, as I mentioned in the earlier part of this presentation, is we identified ammonia and chlorine as top chemicals of concerns. So we looked at these facilities and kind of, you know, develop some site reports to help or to support any sort of potential response or training exercise. And so here we have the Lone Star cold storage. We use a simple, you know, satellite imagery here. Again, that's not too innovative. It's, you know, simply bringing in a satellite base layer with some rail lines and, you know, chemical or facility location. Again, the goal here is to provide some awareness about, you know, what land use or what types of buildings are near the facility. And then we did, you know, a simple buffer to kind of highlight or target, you know, more closely to the surrounding built environment. So here we have a isolation area. And again, I think that's 1,000-foot isolation area. And then we just kind of focused on the immediate buildings. So we have some industrial uses in the northern section, and then residential housing or residential land use in the southern part of this map. And then we kind of just, I guess this was just one of our maps that we're just kind of working with in terms of land use, and just another way of showcasing the different land uses across that facility. And then using the Aloha software, we created these plume model. You can set up your plume models to have different scenarios. Usually you have a report out, and can't remember where or what the conditions were for this scenario, but the idea here is to kind of bring in additional data sources to kind of look at, you know, the sort of critical infrastructure surrounding that facility and in the event of a ammonia or chlorine release. And so this really, you know, again, for pre-planning purposes, this really helps you kind of anticipate any sort of, you know, any sort of kind of actions during the basically it informs your incident response. So whether or not you want to do an evacuation or you want to, you know, make a stay in place order or anything like that. Basically it gives you an idea of what the critical infrastructure around that facility are. And so, again, now we're going to move to some of the more research heavy projects that we worked on with GIS and HAZMAT planning. So the CDC created the Social Vulnerability Index, right? And so they look at four different categories, socioeconomic categories. They're looking at housing, they're looking at income, population, and other factors that make it possible for people to bounce back right after some kind of hazardous event or some kind of hazard event, whether it's, a tornado or earthquake or any kind of, other types of hazards. Basically, they wanted to understand where or across, a certain area, where would it be more difficult for people to recover from any type of hazardous event. And so in the social vulnerability map here, we can see that, University Park area is pretty, it's not highlighted as much as, the southern section of Dallas County. And if you're familiar with Dallas County, the southern section is where it's, predominantly less white and less rich as Highland Park. So we wanted to look at, how can we combine that component of the CDC with chemical hazards. And so we took data from the National Response Center, and that provided historical data that goes back to 20 years ago of any spills or any chemical release. And we combined that with the Social Vulnerability Index to give us a cumulative vulnerability index to, again, highlight areas where we can kind of focus our efforts in terms of, being proactive when it comes to HAZMAT planning, whether, making efforts to outreach at those communities or making emergency or first responder folks aware that, hey, maybe we should be working with these communities. Again, this was kind of more of a research project. It was something that I worked together with one of our graduate interns. This was part of their program requirements. So we got together, we decided, okay, well, how can we bring GIS and how can we bring in public health into creating something that can benefit, our efforts in terms of HAZMAT planning. And as I mentioned earlier, during the Deer Park fire, we had one of our commissioners, curious about whether or not we had any incidents or sorry, any similar facilities in Dallas County. So we went ahead and kind of did a simple analysis of those facilities. So I think what I looked for, or what I did a search in our Cameo or in our tier two reports are, I searched for chemicals that were related or relevant to the same ones that were involved in the Deer Park fire. So I think NAFTA was one of them. And so we kind of did a quick search of the of our chemical inventory and pulled out some facilities that, are similar or had the similar chemicals that were involved in the Deer Park incident. And then again, it's not, it was more of, the commissioner was interested in what we had, and we were able to showcase, using GIS, some of the things that we can, basically we were able to answer a question from our commissioners who are always, interested in using tools like this. And they were, impressed by what we did here. And as I mentioned earlier, the TCEQ has a portal where you can look at or search any fines that facilities have had over the last, however long it's maintain those records. And each chemical facility that we have in our database has an RN number. So if you look at the highlighted portion in the slide, we created a quick Python script to take the RN numbers for our facilities and ran it against the database here. And then we built a spreadsheet or a spreadsheet with all that information. And we were able to then bring that into R and create this web map to, again, help help us kind of understand, you know, which facilities were having fines and kind of get a better picture of what those fines were, you know, were about, whether it's an air violation or some kind of work violation. Again, we were just kind of curious about how we can use or get that information from the TCEQ database here. All right, so this is going to be more of more recent and fun stuff, I think. So as I mentioned earlier, we had issues with the tier two reports, some of the quality or the quality of the locations or reported coordinates. So what we did, we took the locations from the facilities, we ran it against the Esri's geocoder to create two different sets of lat-long coordinates, and then we kind of just mapped out the difference. So here in the map, the red lines represent the difference between what was reported and what we received on the geocoding side from Esri's geocoder. And so basically we visualized the need for, you know, accurate reporting data. So I was, you know, I don't know. This looks like a very simple map, and it is. And the process to get here is pretty straightforward. It's just looking at this. It really helped us kind of talk to facilities like, hey, you know, we need to make sure that you're reporting your information accurately. Because again, if, you know, the whole point of having EPCRA or having the reporting system is to make sure that we are aware of all the different chemicals and that, you know, location is important. And so we were able to create a simple kind of percentage of how many facilities were correct, and which we can then create into a baseline. This means that we can start kind of reaching out to facilities that didn't report the accurate information and try to bring up that percentage up a little bit. You know, it'd be nice to have it at 100%, but I don't think we'll ever get there. But somewhere in the 80s or 90s range would be fine. I mean, but that's just my own take on it. And again, we were able to use the lat-long records from the whatever the facilities reported and use Esri's geocoder to kind of create two sets. And we mapped those out. And again, it was this, I don't know. I really like this one in the middle or somewhere in Irving where it has, you know, one location reported for multiple facilities, right? And so that's a big, you know, red flag for me. And then one of them that I, you know, really enjoy looking at was the Addison. I think it was a makeup company that is located in Addison, but it's showing up all the way down here in DeSoto. So again, you know, we want to make sure that when we're working with the tier two data that, you know, we do some kind of verification process to make sure that we're sharing that with our, to make sure that we're sharing, you know, the right information with our EMs and our first responders. And then using that, we can create a data quality score. And so I think that was the biggest or the missing piece in this data quality score. We've always known that tier two reports have a data quality issue. But to go through and to verify the locations for each of those facilities can be a little bit of a tedious process, right? So I actually, once we created the that map with the lines, we were able to go in and kind of verify line by line which facilities were reporting correct. So the facilities that, you know, misreported, we gave it as, you know, we gave them a zero, and then those who recorded correctly, we gave them a one. And so that was really instrumental in developing this data quality index or score or whatever you want to call it. And so we created one for each of the facilities, and now we have again another baseline regarding, you know, how facilities scored across these different sections. So we looked at the number of contacts that were listed. We looked at missing CAS numbers, and CAS numbers are kind of like the social security of Well, actually, no, not the Social Security. These are unique IDs for the chemicals that, you know, it helps us quickly search for that information on a Cameo or chemical database. And then some of them didn't report a discrete amount or weight for their chemicals. They provided a range, and sometimes, you know, the ranges aren't evenly distributed. Sometimes, you know, if you ever done, when you work with your maps and you classify that range, it could, you know, depending on I don't know if some of you still use natural breaks, right? That's one of the issues that we kind of discovered with the range that the reporting system provided. It wasn't, you know, evenly distributed. So we really wanted to kind of capture and emphasize the need for a discrete amount for the chemical reported. So if you reported, so for example, if you reported 100 pounds and you use the range only, basically the first range goes from 0 to 100, right? But then the next, so that would work for you. You know, it wouldn't be a big deal. But then the next range, I think, goes from 100 to 200 or 500, somewhere around there. And then the ranges just keeps growing exponentially as you go, or as you increase that weight. So again, the whole point for this tier two data quality is to make sure that we're sharing the right information, that we're able to identify facilities that, you know, may need a little added support in terms of how to report that information. The other project that we worked on is the tier two web map. Basically, the EPA Cameo suite does have, the new version does have a mapping component to the tier two report. So this is what a tier two report looks like. This is what the Cameo information will display when you import it into your systems. Basically, you'll have the name of the facility. You can double click on that facility and you'll have information related to, you know, the location, phone numbers, any regulations or IDs. So if they're involved in the federal regulation programs, contacts, chemicals, you know, a lot of information, and it's great. But there's just very limited GIS or very limited mapping application. As you can see on the lower right side here, we have a, you know, small little map widget that you can kind of change between street view and satellite view. You can do, you can show nearby facilities. And again, that's a much better improvement. That's, you know, it's an improvement from the old version, which was kind of really wasn't, you know, helping anyone. So this is the Cameo FM. This is what the previous Cameo version looked like. It wasn't a lot of fun to work with. And I'm glad, you know, there's a new version. But, you know, if you're a emergency manager or a first responder, you want to have that information accessible and easy to work with, right? And so that's, and this is Marplot. This is one of the mapping tools in the Cameo suite. But again, it doesn't have a lot of great functionality. You can click at your locations. You can click at the facilities that are in these eye-looking icons. But when you click on one of those, you don't really get a lot of information. You get, you know, the layer name and the lat long, and that's about it. And so for us, we were wondering, like, how can we make the tier two data easily available? And a web map seems like a pretty straightforward, simple solution to that. And so that's what we created. We created a web map using R and the leaflet package. And then, you know, you can, you know, if you're an emergency manager, you can go in, you can look at the locations, you click on it, you can access all the information that you need. And then if you wanted to, you can also print, and it has a lot of other features, like you can switch, you know, from a gray canvas to a satellite view. You can print. So if you have, you know, if you wanted to print that information, you can go ahead and do that. We added a little bit of JavaScript there to make that possible. And then you can do some very basic kind of, I wouldn't say mapping, but you can draw or annotate this as, you know, as you need, And then we brought in additional layers to this. So again, you know, you can draw, annotate, you can edit these shapes as you want. The other piece is the chemical categorization. So this piece was, again, fun, a lot of work, but it was kind of, because we have over 7,000 chemicals and we wanted to categorize those groups by their hazard and their weight so that we can do some basic data analysis. And so we started off by doing a quick count of, you know, how many, how many chemicals per facilities were out there. So 90% of our facilities reported less than 10 chemicals. And then you have, you know, the big chemical distribution companies reporting, you know, 400, even around 400. And so we also looked at weight. 78% of those chemicals that were reported were less than 50,000 pounds. Polyethylene was, you know, almost 1 million pounds over there. And again, the range here was pretty large. And so it was kind of, for us, when we were trying to come up with the chemical weight groups, it was very arbitrary to say the least. And then once we were able to break this out, we were able to create a simple pie chart to give us an idea of, okay, how out of those 7,000 records or chemicals, where do they fall within this group? And so you can see now that 47% are non-flammable, non-EHS. These are chemicals that, you know, didn't fit any of the other groups. They weren't a toxic inhalation hazard. They weren't an extremely hazardous substance or fuels or flammable. And so we also identified, you know, batteries sometimes because the batteries contain sulfuric acid, they're reported. And then we kind of broke that down by, so this is a chemical breakdown of, you know, weight and by hazard group. So you can see kind of where that distribution is for each weight group. And then we did the same thing for our facilities, right? So each facility was kind of tagged with its highest hazard or chemical hazard. And then we mapped that out. And so, you know, I didn't really see a lot of great stuff happening here, but it was just something that we can kind of take a look at. I thought it was, you know, pretty, again, it's an experimental project. We were just throwing things at the wall, you know, so that's what we kind of saw. Again, not a lot of, aha moments, but it was just kind of like, oh, okay, so this is what we saw. Batteries were the most common in the less than 5,000 group. Once you get between 50,000 and 1 million, fuels take up a lot of that chunk, and then 1 million plus, it's a mixture of fuels and extremely hazardous substances. And then, so I'll wrap up a conversation with the tier two facility priority score. So we've done a lot of work so far related to data, and now it's more like, okay, how do we provide a list of facilities for each jurisdiction and at the county level that make it easier for emergency managers to kind of sift through and identify priority areas? And so, you know, using the products that we've already created, like the data score, the hazard group, the weight group, the vulnerability index, we group those together to generate a priority score to help emergency managers and first responders identify, you know, basically facilities that they want to, you know, focus on. And the cool thing about this, yes, I just said cool. Sorry. The cool thing about this is that you can bring this into a sort of responsible area shapefile for your fire districts. And then some fire districts have three shifts, right? And you can do a quick spatial join to identify which shift and in which district is responsible for that. And so now you're able to provide even a quick list to all these different shifts in terms of, you know, because each shift is responsible to do, or at least in the city of Dallas, is responsible for one site visit a month. And so this one, this priority score really helps kind of identify, you know, or prioritize the facilities that they want to go in and make sure that they're familiar with in the event of an incident. And so I know I covered a lot. And to summarize, you know, we're working with GIS to make sure that we have a better understanding of all the different hazardous materials out there, that we share that information, and that that information is accurate, right? And so I think in terms of, you know, our data work, I think we've pretty much exhausted a lot of the tier two data analysis. Our next step is to kind of focus on developing GIS workshops to get the EMs and the first responders more familiar with GIS tools. Following that, we want to integrate the tier two data that we worked on and incorporate that with existing GIS departments. And then here are some ideas that I'm throwing at the wall. Is there a way that we can automate these plans? Is there a way that we can automate the, you know, a whole report using Python or some kind of a mixture of Python and other software workflows to automate these reports? And then drones, I know that that was a big thing, or that's something, and we like to kind of, I like to see how we can incorporate that into our hazmat workflow. And then dashboards, I mean, dashboards are, is what everybody seems to be asking for nowadays. So I figured, sure, maybe we can look at dashboards now that we have all this data tools and products that we've, you know, created so far. And so, yeah, that pretty much covers my end. I really want to make sure that we have, you know, at least 10 minutes to do any Q&As. So,
okay. Well, Bernardo, thank you. And it's a fantastic presentation. We'll go ahead and go through some questions and answers. But while I'm doing that, we forgot to mention this a little bit earlier. And when we started, is if anybody can, everybody can go into the chat window, just kind of let us know where you're located. We always like to know where you're located across Texas, the United States, and across the world. So, Ollie, let's go ahead and kind of address some of our questions here. Are you, you got one, or you want me to?
Sure. Do you coordinate with the adjacent counties and regions to share ideas, analysis, and data?
That was, you're muted. There you go.
No, that's fine. That was Tim. Hi, Tim. How are you? So, you know, one of the things that, and this being Texas, I feel comfortable that, you know, I can talk about this freely. There's a lot of, you know, rivalry around counties. You know, I know when I first moved here, you know, Dallas folks were like, oh, Texas, you know, Houston, and Houston folks were like, oh, Dallas. And I'm like, okay. And in my previous role, it was more concentrated in the city of Dallas. But when you move it at the county level, it's kind of like, okay, each, you know, Tarrant County is going to do their own thing. And so we've done mutual or joint LEPC meetings with Tarrant County. And I have shared this presentation in the past at the North Texas Regional GIS meeting. In terms of, you know, to answer Tim's question, you know, do I coordinate with adjacent regions or counties? We've tried to do that, but I think one of the biggest challenges that we've all had to deal with was COVID. And so a lot of our plans were kind of, you know, put to the wayside in terms of, you know, showcasing what we're doing and sharing a lot of this stuff. And one of the reasons why I jumped on this call, or, you know, jumped on the offer to join you, is because I want to, you know, showcase this work, and I want to have that collaboration happening, not just in this region, but across Texas, because, you know, as you saw early on in the presentation, there are a lot of incidents happening in Texas that we want to, you know, be ready for and prepare for. And so I hope that that was a good answer.
Yeah, no, that was a great answer. Let's see here. So we have some more, Ollie.
Just some comments. Great simple test for the addresses. Another question is, do you have any evacuation analysis or planning for potential chemical incidents in your county?
So we have a lot of pre-plans in terms of evacuation. That's going to be, so when you're dealing with incidents, each city takes ownership of that. So it's going to vary from city to city, right? We have a annex or a hazmat emergency response plan But that provides just a high level overview of, you know, who's responsible, how do we set up ICS or incident command for this event. And even then, it's only focused for the unincorporated areas, right? And so, you know, one of the challenges is, you know, each city is will have its own department, its own EM folks. But we, you know, I would like to look at that and explore it further.
Okay. Well, we got a few more minutes here. Mehmet has a question for you. Are the facilities using remote sensors to detect leaks real time and trigger some notifications?
So each, again, you're going to have facilities like TI in Richardson that are going to be, you know, pushing for, you know, new ways to set up their systems, updating their systems. Some facilities aren't as well-funded as TI. And so, you know, it's just, again, it's going to vary from facility to facility. But, you know, one of the ways that we get notified is we have a 24-hour duty officer call. And that's kind of the easiest way to, you know, ring us up and tell us, hey, this is happening. So for example, during the Grand Prairie fire, we had one of their emergency managers call me up at 3 a.m. I happened to be the duty officer that day, or yeah, throughout that week. And so that's how I, you know, got a call about that incident. So, you know, we like to be, or we like to think that we can be more real time, but, you know, a phone call does the same thing.
Okay. Can you flash the last slide? I think someone wanted to see your slide before this one. Let's see here. Well, we got some people from all over, Bernardo. We got Tucson, we got McKinney, Denton, San Antonio, Fort Worth, Texas. Let's see here. Ollie, am I missing a question? Is Eric had one? Let's see. Yeah, do Eric has one.
Yeah. Do all facilities submit digitally or online?
So in Texas, if you're a facility and you have a reportable quantity and whatever chemical that is, or if it's a chemical that is listed in the extremely hazardous substance, you report to three entities. You report to the TCEQ, you report to the local fire department, and then to the LAPC. And the TCEQ has a, you know, digital reporting system where you have to log in and actually submit it to their database. It used to be a and that was also a new development. You know, that was in 2018 now. Before, when I joined, it was more kind of still a mixture of digital and paper copies. And so we used to get, you know, mail or a paper copy of the reports. And now, you know, because of the TCEQ's move to a centralized reporting system, it's a lot easier to kind of get that those copies and those reports. So if you're a facility, you're reporting these digitally.
Okay. Very nice. You got other folks here from Jersey, Kentucky, or I saw another one here, Virginia, Denver. So I'll ask a couple more questions here before we end this thing.
Do you coordinate with NG911?
And no. So is my understanding is that they're focused more on kind of addressing and, you know, CAD systems, right? I've had you know, discussions with NG911, and our conversations is mostly like, you know, here's some data if you ever need it, or here's a call. So I have, you know, been in contact with them in terms of how to work on any sort of during an incident. I can't think of a way, but I'm sure there's something that we can work on.
Okay. Well, Daniel has one here, or more of a comment. If these facilities have real-time, LOT sensors, there are a lot of great tools to use to create real-time alerts via text/emails and incorporating those alerts on dashboards. He made a recommendation of looking into ArcGIS Velocity. So just kind of...
So yeah, you, I mean, Daniel. And I think it all depends on that company's bottom line, right? And if they see a need for that. So, you know, some of the systems that are still out there are pretty, you know, 20, 30 years old. They're still working, and updating that would require a lot of, you know, capital investments. And, you know, the other piece to that is, you know, I'm not aware, and maybe I need to do a little bit more research, but again, is it a priority? I mean, I think that's the real question, right? Because some of the facilities will have their own response team. So if it's a water treatment plant, the Trinity River Authority, for example, has its own response team. TI has its own response team that are on site, and then they'll call HAZMAT for, you know, awareness and, you know, additional support.
Okay. Well, we're pretty much right here at the top of the hour. Daping has a quick question. How much does the Cameo cost, the software?
Zero. And, it's free. Okay.
Got it. And I guess he says, does it have relevant application programming interfaces, APIs? And
not at all. Okay. neither does the TCEQ's STEERS reporting system. Yeah.
Well, you have the email address and contact information are here. You can contact the info at eurisatexas.org. If you have any questions, we will have this presentation after we clean it up, post it to our YouTube channel very soon, and be looking for your PDHs. Bernardo, thank you for a fantastic presentation today. It was great, and we appreciate you taking the time to sit with us today. Everybody else on the call, we appreciate you all attending the October 2021 Eurisa Texas Speaker Series, and we will see you next month. I'm Brian King, and my co-host has been Ollie Powers, and we really appreciate y'all. Thank you.
Thank you,
Brian.